Right, it's Friday evening, and what have we got here? Well, we've got two burners. Wow, when I was about 12 years old, I can't tell you how much I wanted one of these. Back in the 80s, and I got my little Rotel RVC 220 from Argos for £19.99. There's the Rotel RVC 220. Beautiful. And, yeah, I couldn't tell you how much I wanted one of these. Little did I know, you know, how good or bad it would be. I thought it was going to be brilliant. Of course it wasn't. And there was a little a second-hand shop in a little lane called Church Lane near where I live. And I saw this power amplifier in the front window, and he wanted £5 for it. And back in 1982, that was quite a lot of money. And for me, it was anyway. And but anyway, I managed to purchase said burner and used it for a short while until it stopped working, and I had no idea how to fix it, and I think eventually it just went in the bin. But now I think I've got a bit of an idea of how to fix these things, and we've got two to look at today. These are from my friend Steve, who sends me a lot of radios in for repair, and so I think we'll look at the rougher one of the two first, the AP25. This bad boy over, it really is. It does look like it could do with a little bit of a clean. So we'll give it a little bit of a clean first. The reason I'm going to do this is because I know for these, before I take these apart, that you can actually get fairly reasonably priced power transistors for these from China. And so I might end up doing that, because these are, after all, even though, you know, a lot of people don't like these things, or some people do, they're still, I would classify now as a vintage piece of hardware. So I think they are worth saving, even if you don't even turn them on and use them. So let's clean the back of this up, and then we'll take the screws out. Right, that's a little bit less grimy. Let's take out these two screws and extract the front cover, and then we'll get our transistor tester onto it just to test the transistors working. That's very important. If you do test one of these yourself, you don't go connecting it up to your CB before you've actually checked that it works or that the transistor is good out of the radio, because you can certainly cause some damage to your CB radio as well if you're not careful. Okay, well, opening this one up, we can see a little problem to the left here where the power leads are coming in, so obviously that's got stretched at some point. And there's a bit more in here than I actually first thought. I know the one that I had back in the day definitely didn't have a relay in it, and it was a very basic affair. So there seems to be a little bit more going on in this one, so let's explore some more. Okay, to release it from captivity, you undo these two bolts, or nuts as they are, and they're from a 5mm, I think it was 5mm, let's just check, 5.5mm socket to fit that, so that's probably imperial. 5.5mm, and do those two nuts, and then you have to desolder where the PL259 comes in through there, and this should just technically just lift out of the case. As you can see, I need my other hand free. You also need to unscrew the center screw there, which goes into in through the tab in the RF power amplifier chip, as you'll see when we take this out of the board. And you can see the there's the power amplifier on the back. I was expecting like a tabbed gold leaf power amplifier on here. And if you've ever wondered, there is the insides. And there's an insulation washer on there. So one would have screwed that there's a, assuming there's a tab on the screw going through there, which looks a little bit worn. So first thing to do is to clean up the transistor and test it. It's got a T on it, so it must be alright, see? As you all know, using the multi-function tester TC1, we've just disconnected two of the leads out of the board here, and we've got our three connectors on there, and we can do a test with it in place, because the third leg was a bit of a bugger to get out. So we can see there that that transistor's looking okay, it's testing fine. And we've got a working transistor, which is good. Now, it'd be nice to see what transistor that is, so we can verify some of its claims first. So perhaps we'll sneak a look. We'll bend the legs up a little bit and be very careful, and then we can actually
find out what transistor that is, because of course it might not be the original transistor. So I stand corrected, I have the data sheet, and on the data sheet it tells us there the output power VCC at 12 volts or 13 watts with a PT here of 25 watts. Now I'd be amazed if you get a maximum of 25 watts out of that transistor, but I could be wrong. But what we shall do is, obviously, we can now put a new power lead on this, and we'll quickly connect it up on the bench just to make sure it's switching with a load on the back of it. And then what we do, just for fun, is we do a little test with Mick down the road to see how many more S points it gives us. And I bet you it won't make a great deal of difference. So there you go. So yes, it is the correct transistor. Right, so the relay is obviously in there, so when you transmit, when you finish transmitting, it switches the receive and it bypasses the power transistor on receive. And to do that, it picks up on the incoming side from the TX circuit from your CB, switches that transistor, which will in turn switch this relay on. So we could simulate that action with a bit of 12 volt DC-ishness. And we'll just make sure that that relay is actually switching. Now you can see the actual mechanism, quite interesting. For you see the contacts sliding over there, and they both appear to be switching okay. We will actually check their resistance with a meter just to make sure. That's good, that indicates that the relay is working. Now whether that transistor is going to switch it, we'll find out. Right, now we've got the relay hooked up here. We've got the continuity tester on the two pins here of the relay. Let's select ohms, and we've got 1.6 ohms. That's the normally closed state of that pair of contacts, and we've got normally open there. And if we move the contact over to here, we'll have the other pair of contacts. 1.5 ohms, and they open there. So I'm happy that that relay is okay. Like I say, the only thing that we might possibly run into now is the transistor. So to be honest, it's worth testing that transistor. We've got the board out, and it really isn't a problem to do that. So let's take that little transistor out and test it before we do anything else. And I think we can just pop a new power lead on this and give it a little tune-up. And it is an MBC237. So let's pop it in the tester and see what happens. Ah. Resistor. Could this be why it was sat in a box of CB junk for such a long time, Steve? Huh? So I'm going to try in another pair of connections. It might just be a bad connector. 312. Again. Ah. Resistor. We know it's not a resistor, don't we? So I think that's probably found the problem. And it's worth, that was worth checking, wasn't it, before we put that back in. So, the only other components that probably would be worth changing is a little capacitor there, which we'll swap out, and we will test these diodes on the board with a diode tester just to make sure they're okay. But that just shows you it's worth checking that, and so we'll look that up and we'll pop an equivalent transistor in there. Well, I just went to my transistor box, and we've got a 2N2222A transistor, which matches it as near as makes no difference. The only difference being that the we'll have to spin the transistor around the other way because the collector and the emitter pins are different, but as the base is in the middle, we're okay. So let's do that. Well, there's the transistor mounted in place, and we'll just get the set the meter onto diode testing, and we'll just have a little flip round, test the diodes in the board. Get this shorting it out on the plate there. We get the green light, which is good. That's our diode test. We reversed them for this diode. I mean, I'm sure these diodes are okay. Again, I'm shorting these out. Let's just do it one more time. 0.6 there. And we'll check the flyback diode, which is across the relay, of course. 0.25. A little bit low, that, isn't it, for a... we're probably measuring some of the coil as well there. I'm sure that diode is okay. We'll just reverse the connections and see what... Yeah, I think it's just because it's across the coil. Now we'll solder the connections back on to the RF power transistor. We're happy all of our stuff is okay now. So we'll just get in here and do that. Being careful not to overheat this transistor. Although, you know, in CB land, these things do tend to run a tad on the warm side. I forgot we've got one more polarity protection diode to test, and we should do that straight away. Get our leads around the right way, and that one's okay as well. Ah, just move that out. You didn't see that, did you? It's the glare and the spotlight. Right, my camera's flashing that it needs a new battery, so let's do that. Okay, so the only thing left to do is to replace this capacitor. And this burner, it looks like it's from the early 80s, I'd say. There's no date on it, but we'll change that. We'll change the capacitor anyway, just, you know, because it needs changing. So, yeah, 10 microfarad, 16 volt. And I always change them for a higher voltage rating when I do this. So let's just test this one. We've got 12.62 microfarads. Little bit higher than 10, but that'll be fine. So let's pop that bad boy in. I just tested the capacitor that came out, and it was 12 microfarads as well, so I'm sure that capacitor was probably okay, and I can't see any signs of degradation or wear. To be honest, it's very likely that that transistor blew fairly early on in its age, and it's more than likely for the main power transistor to go in these, so I'm quite surprised that it didn't, but that's good that it didn't. Right, and the final thing to do would be to put a new lead onto this, and I've got some fuse carriers, so I'll pop a we'll determine what kind of current it draws on there and see what kind of fuse I put in. I've actually got some old car fuse carriers which I might use, just because I've got them, and might be up to, well, it might be a few amps, so we'll see. Anyway, we'll see what kind of current it draws. I've no idea. Do we try it? Okay, we have our new power lead connected. So I'm quite happy that we can pop this back in the case and plug all our leads in. We will get a put some fresh heatsink compound on the back of the transistor there, and we'll put a new screw, a new washer on the tab as well. And yeah, hopefully this will be good to use again on the amateur radio bands. Non-CB. One little bag of washers. Now it's well worth, when you try to change these, to inspect them, because I've seen in the past where other people have put worn ones back in the bag, so it's always worth checking the tabs. Now these aren't the best quality ones, I have to say. These were an eBay special, but we'll nonetheless check once we've put it in that we haven't got any continuity where we shouldn't have it. And the tiniest bit of gunge on here, and spread it all about, as they say. You really don't need much of this stuff. Because all that will happen is it will just go around the sides and go absolutely everywhere. And I don't recommend you use your finger either, but hey ho. There we go, nice even covering. And we'll plopsky him back inside. And the final act, just driving the little nuts down, and then we should be ready for a bit of a test. Now I'll probably do that in the morning. It is now Friday night, and I'm probably going to sit down with a cup of tea and watch something on the television. And right, I'm happy that's all in there and looking dandy. So in the morning we shall connect it up to probably a Colt 295, which I've got on the bench over there, and we'll test it with Mick to see if it makes any difference. Right, we're back. Okay, what we'll probably just do here is there's a little bit of corrosion in the sockets there. You can see that there. So we'll get a cotton bud in there, and we'll give those a little bit of a clean. Might even put something a bit more abrasive in there just to clean those up, and we'll make sure that the actual plugs are fitting nicely in there first, and then we'll just do a couple of basic checks with the meter on there before we connect it up to the CB, just to make sure we've got what we should have there. Right, much cleaner now, and if you can see in there, nice and shiny. Use a tiny little bit of metal polish. You guys might have seen this stuff, obviously if you're in the UK you would have done. I use this a lot on the metal parts on radios. It really brings them up. You don't need much, just a tiny little bit, and then once you've polished it, spray some switch cleaner in there and let it all rinse out, and then give it a dry with a clean cotton bud. I think our friends in the States call them Q-tips, but that is what we call them here. So I'm going to just do a couple of quick tests with the meter to make sure I'm happy with how it's settled in the RX state, and we'll then plug it in and see if we can make any of these adjustments make any difference. Okay, all we're looking for here is that we've got a straight continuity in between the two sockets now. We've got 0.78, 0.8 of an ohm, and that's going through the relay inside there, so we know that's okay. And we've got absolutely no resistance between the positive terminal of that one and the positive terminal of that one and the case. So as long as we present a 50 ohm dummy load, we do have a 100 watt dummy load at the end of this chain, we should be okay. And what we will do, we will measure the power of what we're putting into it first, because obviously that's relative to how much power we get out of this. So we'll measure the relative power of the CB that we're going to use to drive this, and then we'll have a look at what we're getting on the meter. Okay, we've got a Colt 295A, which I've just serviced. We've got a brand new patch lead, and we'll get this all connected up. Okay, we've got the Colt 295A all powered up, and we're keying up into the dummy load, and let's just see what kind of power it's doing. Okay, it's doing 5 watts. I'll just show you on the meter. Okay, this is the Colt 295A, and we're doing just shy of 5 watts there. So we know we've got some good power going in, and let's see what difference the amp makes. Okay, it's a little bit dimly lit down here, but we've got the Colt, and as with any test, when you're testing any kind of equipment like this, we'll start the Colt off in low power, and that will be 0.4 of a watt, and I know that because I set it as that just the other day. And so let's give it a try. So we should be getting roughly about 5 watts out if this is working. So there we go. You see the relay is clicking as we're transmitting, and you can see there we've got our low power on the meter. What are we getting out? That's what you all want to know. There we go, we're getting 4 watts. We're getting a full 4 watts out into the dummy load, so that's excellent. So what we need to do now then is pop it into high power, and then wonder what we get there. So let's have a look. Okay, now I know what's happening there. We're going over current. You see this? See it dropping the supply down. That's a good thing about having a current limiting supply. So let's pop the current limit up. I think it's going to draw a couple of amps. So let's pop it up on here with the adjuster. Let's bring you in. Let's give us, bearing in mind, we've only got a 3 amp fuse. Let's try 3.5. We need to take it up more than that, guys. Oh no, be careful, don't hit the wrong one. Okay, let's go for 5 amps. 5.5. There we go, we're drawing 4 amps. That was about right then. So it's going to draw 4 amps. But what power? What power, ye asks? Let's have a look. Bearing in mind we're on the 20 watt scale just there. Oh, right, banging right over. Goodness gracious. Let's try. So now we've moved it up to the 200 watt scale. So yeah, it's doing nearly 30 watts there, according to the 30, 40, 50. So that's doing nearly 30 watts. Wow. That isn't too bad, is it, for a, well, it must be 40 years old. And yes, it definitely wasn't working beforehand. I didn't mention that at the start of the video. So that was the main fault with this, was that the switching transistor at the front of it. And yeah, that seems to have got some action there, doesn't it? Now, I could go and try and tweak and adjust this front end to get a little bit more out of this. But if I do that, I'll do it on the low power setting. Okay, so we've got this suspended up in the air here. Go and keep a good eye on it. And we'll keep a good eye on the power meter. And that's a kind of angle I need for the shot, so I'll get my tripod. I kind of need extra long arms for this, but I think we've got most of this in shot now. So we're going to key up in low power, and we're getting just over 4 watts on the meter there, you can see. So we'll have a little tweak. And these are quite stiff. There we go. Okay, so it's almost peaked. We're going to get a... come to the peak there. Okay, so that's 5 watts we're doing. That's good. Going down. Yeah, so that's about peak. Oh, getting a bit more there. I think we're on the limit there, so we're doing 7. Now I'm going to wind that back a little bit to 6. Okay, you don't want to blow the output transistor in this thing at the end of the day. And because we can just keep taking it up, so I don't want to... We've dropped off again there, see? Yeah, so I'm gonna leave that for 7, because the trouble is when we go up to the top end, we don't want to be overdriving the thing. And this is quite a generous radio, so this is doing 5 watts. So most of the radios, well, all of them I set down to 4, obviously. So so we should see a bit of a difference now in the main power. So let's go back up to the 200 watt scale. Yeah, it's gone up a little bit. Hard to say because we haven't quite got the resolution, but we've probably gained about 4 or 5 watts out of it. So yeah, I'm really pleased with that. That is superb. That's definitely gone from a piece of scrap to a useful amplifier. Now I must put a caveat in here. Obviously, if you're in the UK, that is not legal for you to use on CB. And I have to say that because I'm a radio amateur. And it's my duty to mention such things to you guys. Now, I'm fully aware that people use a lot more power than that on CB, of course, but I have to mention it. And we will do a short test with Mick tomorrow, just to show you really how little difference that will make between me and Mick in our QSO. And it might put you off even using one of these, really, but it will make some difference, of course, don't get me wrong, but... I don't think it's going to make the difference people, and certainly me as a 12-year-old, actually thought it would do. So I'm going to go to bed now. It's really late. And next shot, hopefully, it will be with Mick, and we'll have a chat. Right, we're all set up. We've got the lead on now, the case, and a fuse, and we'll see if Mick's about. Hi there, Mick. I wonder if you're about.
Yeah, I am about full, sorry, I just had to turn the volume down on the other one a bit. And, now I'm fit to go and give you a report.
Okay, Rog, this is the AP25 25 watt burner going through the Colt. Now, I've got the Colt set on low power, so we should be doing about 5 to 6 watts, maybe a little bit more, maybe 7. I've gone straight through the aerial here rather than the meter, just because there's less losses for all my stuff here. So, this is it on 7 watts, Rog, about that. And then I'll switch it into high power mode if you can let me know what the difference is, Rog.
On that, it's loud at the moment, I must admit. Nearly all the white noise is gone as well. It's really got rid of that, so which is, well, it should do, shouldn't it? It's cutting through it. Okay, so yes, good at the moment.
Okay, Rog, we should be doing we're pulling 3.8 amps out of the supply, so we're doing 26 27 watts now. I wonder how much difference that's made to the signal.
Voice wise, still very good indeed, nice and clear audio, and there is no white noise at all on the signal, none at all. So you're hitting me with a good strength, you must be.
Yeah, Rog, okay, yeah, we probably need to probably do a bit more of a thorough test on that then, so where I go a bit further away. So you would say it's making a bit of a difference then?
Definitely making more than a difference, Paul. It's very good quality audio. Although you're only giving me 3 bars, but I don't know why that is. I would have expected it to go end stop on that sort of power, but no, it's still very good.
Yeah, that's it. I think you need a considerable amount more power to get any visible difference on the S meter, don't you? I know that from first principles of radio stuff. So, I think it will. We'll perhaps have to do a test where I'll go a bit further afield just to see what difference it makes. But of course, then the problem we'll have is that I won't be able to hear you very well. So, okay. Well, thanks for that. That's brilliant. I just wanted to make sure it works, and I'm definitely really pleased that it's working really, really well, and it's definitely thumping out those watts.
Okay, I've got the Colt 295A, and we've got it with the AP25 watt burner. We're on low power here. I'm just going to switch over to high power now. This is now jumped into high power, so we should be doing about 27 watts, and then we're going to drop down back to low power, back down to the 7 watts-ish mark, and then back up to high power, which is 27 watts, Rog.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think that does make quite a bit of difference. I don't know what you think. Obviously, we're getting, what's helping here is the fact that we're getting about 7 watts, through the system to mic there, so that's improved the signal somewhat. So yeah, they do make a difference. Now, like I say, a bit naughty to use, we've just done this on a limited test, but I won't be using a burner here in my setup on CB. It was just done as a little test just to show you what you can expect if you do invest in one of these. And I know people do, and I know people do sideband, and I know they do free band and everything else. I'm not here to judge anyone. Everybody knows the laws. Well, I say everybody, but most people know what they can and can't do, and what they're supposed to do and what they're not supposed to do. I'm just here to show you what you can do, and also to show you mainly how to fix these lovely old radios. And that's a cracker, that one. That's a good one, Steve, that 295. So that'll be going on eBay soon, so keep an eye out. Right then, we'll catch you on the next one. I hope you've enjoyed this one. I know it's been a bit of a long one, but I suppose I better look at the other one. I got another one to look at. There you go. So I'll do that one next, and we'll see how we get on. Right, catch you later.